Hello and welcome to India's World. Prime Minister Narendra Modi, during his visit to France, has sought to infuse new energy into the strategic partnership between the two countries. He surprised everyone by placing an order for 36 Rafale ready-to-fly fighter jets from France directly. He thus bypassed the protracted negotiations which have delayed the purchase of the planned 126 Rafale aircraft up to now. The Indian Ministry of External Affairs has described the visit of the Prime Minister as extremely successful. It has cited concrete results shown not only in the area of defence cooperation, but also in the field of nuclear energy, space research, agreement on smart cities, easier French visas for Indians, and helping Indian students in skill development after finishing their higher studies in France. To discuss the evolving Indo-French relations in the context of Prime Minister Modi's visit and the surprise direct purchase of Rafale aircraft, we have with us three distinguished experts. We have with us Ambassador Rakesh Sood. He has served as India's ambassador to France, Afghanistan and Nepal. He was also a permanent representative to the Conference on Disarmament in Geneva. And we have Professor R.K. Jain. He's director of the Europe Area Studies Program of Jawaharlal Nehru University. He also holds the Jean Monnet Chair in European Integration and International Relations at the university. And we are lucky to have with us an eminent strategic affairs expert, Air Vice Marshal Kapil Kak. He is an independent voice on strategic affairs, a commentator in newspapers, and he's also the convener of Indo-US Dialogue on Security, sponsored by the RAND Corporation. I welcome you gentlemen to the show, this discussion. Ambassador Sood, let me begin with you. What is your overall assessment of Prime Minister Modi's visit to France? Do you agree with the External Affairs Ministry when it says it was an extremely successful visit and that it met all the key goals that were targeted? What were the key goals that that this visit sought to achieve?
Well, one thing I think which we all know is that India and France have had a strategic partnership since 1998. In fact, France is the first Western major power with which India established a strategic partnership. Now, normally what we understand by strategic partnership are sensitive sectors like nuclear, defense, space, intelligence sharing, and so on. This is what we would call the government-to-government leg of the relationship. And this has always been strong with France. And some of the decisions that have been announced give further strength to this particular leg. The two legs which are not, or which have traditionally not been as strong, are the business-to-business leg and the people-to-people leg. And I think some of the announcements made, which are there in the joint statement that has been issued, show that these are the other two legs on which there has been focus. So I suppose one can say that in that sense, it has been a successful visit.
Okay. Professor Jain, do you agree with Ambassador Sood? And would you also say that the two areas of key strategic partnership between India and France were defense and nuclear energy? Do you think enough has been achieved in both these areas?
I think that of the four strategic partnerships that we have in Europe, the French and the British are the ones which have had greater, have been more substantial, and therefore there was a strong need, since Prime Minister Modi has not visited Europe. Yeah. At making France his first destination was extremely important to generate new life into both these things. And I think given the idea of making India, because France had traditionally focused on big ticket deals, and there has been a lack of the involvement of a broad spectrum of French companies into India's economic development, especially the SMEs. More importantly, I think, this out-of-the-box thinking, though some reservations and questions remain, of trying to revive this defense relationship with France, and especially in trying to involve the private sector into certain key technologies, I think from that point of view, the visit was a very successful one, though, of course, it has also raised a number of questions which need to be addressed.
Okay. Marshall, among other things, you're also an Air Force man, as your title suggests. So what was the signal you think the Prime Minister was trying to send to France when he suddenly announced the direct purchase of 36 fighter jets? And that too at a time when the deal for 126 aircraft that were to be purchased was getting nowhere.
No, I don't think he announced it suddenly. It seemed to the world that this was out of the box and suddenly done. Yeah. Weeks before this, there were negotiations going on, not necessarily the negotiations which earlier went on between the Ministry of Defense and Dassault, but other channels.
Dassault Aviation is the manufacturer of these
jets.
Yes,
but I think I want to go beyond the, we'll discuss Rafael perhaps later. I think you asked the question about what were the goals. I think if we are clear of the goals, then we'll say whether it was successful or not. I think Prime Minister Modi, and in this case, his foreign secretary, over many weeks, have been very clearly enunciating that India will be a leading power and not a stabilizing power. What does leading power mean? A, it will be assertive, it will be self-confident, it will be integrationist in approach, and last but not least, it will have a very nimble decision-making and out-of-the-box solution to problems. I think what we see in France is a clear demonstration because
so Rafael is out-of-the-box, you're saying?
In this way, but more importantly, I was trying to define the goals. More importantly, we then come to what Mr. Modi has been saying for the last 11 months, that domestic policy, domestic development, technological innovation and absorption, it will drive all our outreach in foreign policy terms. So therefore, we are actually looking at leading power, confident, very clear about what it, how it wants to achieve domestic and technological development through an international network. France and whatever the visits are coming up, I think in that sense has been, to my mind, a great success.
So very clear cut. Thank you for contextualizing the visit.
Yes.
But going back to this decision, Rafael, Rakesh, what do you think of these last-minute decisions? Do you think Modi made the announcement to signal a certain decisiveness to ensure that the visit was not fruitless? I mean, imagine if he had gone there and again you would have said, we will ask officials to hasten the negotiations. Do you also think the decision is actually out of a certain frustration because you would want to improve ties with France, but the negotiations actually pull you down all the time?
Well, Bharat, it is true that these negotiations have now been going on for more than 3 years, even after the bids, financial bids, L1, etc. was announced. And it is also true that the negotiations have been difficult negotiations. During the last 2 years, I think the French defense minister has come over at least 2 times to talk to his Indian counterpart. So I guess there is a degree of frustration that is building up. Secondly, there has been a depletion in the Indian Air Force in terms of the number of aircraft and the depleting number of squadrons that we keep reading about. One important issue that I'd like to flag here is that though Prime Minister Modi and President Hollande announced that there would be a purchase at a government-to-government level of 36 aircraft, I have not seen anything to indicate as to what is the fate of the ongoing negotiations.
We're going to discuss that. But we need to take a break at this point. Don't go away. We'll be back again with this interesting discussion. Welcome back. We're discussing Indo-French relations in the context of Prime Minister Modi's visit to France. Air Marshal Kak, Ambassador Sood flagged, that we don't know what's the fate of the main negotiation. So my question to you is this, based on the joint statement, which says, the two leaders agreed to conclude an intergovernmental agreement for supply of the aircraft on terms that would be better than conveyed by Dassault Aviation, that means cheaper, as part of a separate process underway. Now, does this mean there will be two separate negotiations now? One, to determine the price of the 36 direct purchase Rafales, and another, a parallel process, for the 126 aircraft that we've been negotiating for the last 3 years?
Actually, as Rakesh very very correctly pointed out, that is the key unsaid part of this agreement. But how has this changed the dynamics of the process so far? One, it has said a goodbye to the RFP, request for proposals, which is the basic document under which all negotiations with Dassault have taken off so far with the Ministry of Defense. The second is there is no question of a lowest bidder. A Dassault won on a lowest bidder. It's a very dynamic process. I have been recommending this for the last 15 years in my writings. Look at innovative ways to do business rather than the good old Soviet style 1950s.
No, but you're not answering the question. Are there two processes going on parallelly? One for determining the price of these 36 direct purchase aircraft with longer maintenance commitment by France, and another for 126?
What will happen is that the negotiations will immediately go on for the pricing and the delivery mechanism. Delivery mechanisms is also important, because although Defense Minister Parikar has said 2 years, press is speculating 3 years. Even if you do it in 2 years, it meets the necessity of
Air Force. We'll come
back.
But
on the other part is very crucial. Yeah. Other part, many things could happen. One could be, okay, we will go along with you. He has also the option to abandon that and go along with some other people. There are countries in Europe who have been contending for this, and now you have three countries. You have Eurofighter coming in, you have the Saab aircraft coming in. So you can, what's the key? I mean, this is the point you raised. Key is technology transfer.
But
that is
But in the case of the 36 aircraft, Professor Jain, the offset has not been described. By offset, as you know, what we mean is how much of the money that the French get would they reinvest in India to develop our defense capabilities?
Government to government, there are no
offsets. There are no offsets in 36.
So that's out.
So we've done away with technology transfer as far as these 36 aircraft are concerned. Assuming, as the joint statement suggests, that there's a parallel process going on, then are we now buying, instead of 126 aircraft, 162 aircraft, because 126 plus 36, or are we buying only 90 aircraft, 126 minus 36?
I think a very plausible explanation will be that Prime Minister Modi wants to solidify the defense connection in a long-term perspective with France. And we are looking at perhaps greater engagement with France.
Yeah.
I think, you know, apart from the critical needs of the Air Force, you're going to see further negotiations. And there has also been some speculation that because the Reliance Group has an MOU with Dassault in 2012, there is some speculation that perhaps the remaining 126 or 106 aircraft would perhaps be given to the private sector.
And not to HAL?
That remains debatable, because, you know, there were reservations on 2 points. One was whether adequate quality could be ensured. Yeah. The pricing was technology transfer. And also, you know, whether the respective timelines could be met. Yeah. And we already have the experience of the Scorpion submarine deal where timelines have not been respected.
Let me take the timeline question to you. But you want to say something before that?
I just wanted to say that when we talk about costs or terms which are very beneficial compared to the original negotiation for 126, it is very difficult to make these comparisons. Because here, you're talking of 36, all of them are going to be manufactured in France.
Flyaway condition.
Flyaway condition. Secondly, there is, as you said, no transfer of technology. So we don't set up an assembly system here. Earlier, we were looking at life cycle costs. We were looking at 50% offset, which is higher than that mandated under our current defense procurement policy, which is 30%. Yeah. Secondly, we were also saying that after the first 18, which were going to come in flyaway, from there onwards, from the 19th onwards, there would be indigenization. And by the time the 126th aircraft was inducted into the Indian Air Force, it would consist of 80% Indian content, which is a huge step forward.
But all that could be overboard if we believe that one extra option that Air Marshal Kak has put on the table, that you buy 36 from them and the rest you go deal with somebody else.
But then you have to redo the whole thing. I mean, then you have to scrap the old RFP if you have to do that.
So that RFP already stands scrapped. By this. The RFP is gone.
That means
lowest tender is gone. Offsets don't apply because it's intergovernmental.
So just 36 and nothing more.
This is like the Mirage 2000s the Indian Air Force bought in 1985. Okay. There were no assembly. Overalls were not done here, whether it's airframe or engines. You got the Mirage 2000 here, flew them, done brilliantly in Kargil, and have now upgraded them.
So you've actually satisfied the Air Force somewhat by giving them two more squadrons?
Yes,
and saying that, you know, although you have a sanction set in the 42, you operate with now, instead of 36, 38.
Oh, and well, 34 at the moment.
34.
At 34, you will go to 2 more squadrons, yeah. So you'll get 36, yeah. But you're still short of 9 squadrons, which is a critical aerospace.
Yeah. Okay, quickly.
Well, just one point, you know, I think it was also a question of the Modi government's credibility to encourage cooperation in the defense sector. The French have been frustrated for long, and we have
but
not...
But what you gain is only short-term credibility.
That's true, but I think, you know, there are certain unsaid things, you know, which we will probably okay. discover right. later on.
Quickly, on Rakesh, on this, the timing. Now, as Air Marshal said, Defence Minister Parikar has said that, you know, within 2 years they'll be inducted. Now, I fail to see how, because Dassault's capacity is only of 12 aircraft a year. There is an order pending of 24 aircraft from Egypt, yes. FLs. 2 to 3 are bought by the French Defence Forces. So, 2 years? In the next 6 years, you know, you'll be lucky if you get all the 36.
Well, I can just say that in the original negotiations in which we were supposed to get 18 in flyaway condition,
yeah.
that delivery of those 18
yeah.
was supposed to be completed over a period of 3 years.
That's right.
So now, if we are getting 36
yeah.
and we are going to get them over a period of 2 years, obviously there has been some discussion to which at least I'm not privy in terms okay. of how production yeah. is going to be ramped up
yeah.
or perhaps the Egyptians are going to be told to wait
yeah.
or maybe the French procurement
yeah.
will be slowed down.
Okay. Sorry, you wanted to say
no,
something?
No, the very good point made here. It's not difficult for Dassault to step up production. It's just that they were not selling aircraft.
Okay.
Egypt came as a kind of a bonus and in a short frame.
Yeah. Yeah.
They can step up,
yeah.
but I think the key element that we have to look at is this business of the remainder aircraft. And I think you reflagged that issue. What options do we have? We have the Eurofighter option. We also have the Swedish option. And of course, we have the French option.
Okay.
Now we can, it's not a difficult proposition if you're doing government to government. We can now say this is a government to government. We've done it with US
okay.
on the C-17,
okay,
on C-130.
I just want to come in here. With
yeah.
government to government, you don't do make in India.
Yeah.
You have.
Outright
you can, you haven't done it so far, but you can do it if
you haven't done it with the French.
Yeah.
In this case,
yeah. Yeah.
Not with
yeah.
the Russians.
But you
okay.
can do this. This is
okay.
what I was talking about. You have signaled that this has changed.
Okay.
Now I have options of flexibility to choose where I want to. And the last point,
yeah.
French have been extremely hesitant to transfer top end of technology. IAF learnt it in the 80s when they refused to give any indication.
So is that why we are not buying even the three Airbus A330 refuelers? Is that why we've ruled them out of 197 helicopters and said we'll go with Russia? What about the surface-to-air missiles with seeker technology?
I won't say that. I mean, that would be too generalized. We don't have the time for
yeah.
it. But in this specific case, if you're
okay.
talking about aircraft deals, what happens, for example, 1990s, there was a negotiation with HAL
yeah.
for a GPS system.
Yeah.
Even the commitments they had made,
okay.
they went back because
okay.
that is a top end of technology which they don't want to give.
All right.
So that is a bigger challenge of RFP because
okay.
RFP, I'm saying, RFP laid out by the Air Force precise nature of the detailed transfer of technology that will take place. It is not so much whether it will
be
HAL or Ambani.
You're saying it's been thrown out of the window, but we've run out of time on this
yes.
segment. We'll be back again with this interesting discussion in a bit. Don't go away. Welcome back. We're discussing Indo-French relations in the context of Prime Minister Modi's visit to France. Mr. Sood, on nuclear cooperation, there are two agreements. One between the Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited and Areva
yeah.
for 6 into 1650 megawatt power plants at Jatapur. And there's another one for transfer of technology between Areva and Larsen & Toubro. Now, my question is, how soon do you see the first agreement being signed? Because it's been stuck on the tariff issue for a long time. India wants per megawatt cost to be rupees 6 point something, while the French are insisting that it will be rupees 9.26 per kilowatt. So do you think it will get sorted out quickly?
Yes, because the two agreements that have been signed, one between NPCIL and Areva, which is the early works agreement or the pre-engineering
yeah.
services agreement, and the one between Areva and Larsen & Toubro, they are in some ways linked. And they have a bearing on the cost issue.
And the link is indigenization.
The link is indigenization. We've been talking about the extent of indigenization because the way the costing negotiations have gone on, it was coming around to somewhere between 8.5 to 9 per unit of power. We wanted to make it comparable to energy, to electricity being generated from other sources, and therefore we wanted to bring it in the range of 6. Now, with greater indigenization, which is one of the key components, which is the pressurized reactor vessel, if that can be done domestically on the basis of designs provided by Areva and match up to the required quality, then we can
bring the cost down. So bigger components and more components being manufactured in India.
True.
Now, Professor Jain, what will be the impact of public sentiment in India on these nuclear power plants? Because public sentiment seems to be against nuclear power plants at Jaitapur. And Shiv Sena, an ally of Bharatiya Janata Party, has openly come out against it. But even if you leave aside public sentiment, Prime Minister Modi has increased India's plans for generating solar power from 20,000 megawatts in the next 5 years to 100,000 megawatts. So doesn't that also impact on the salience of nuclear power in India?
Well, there has been a long debate about the cost at which we generate nuclear power and the time frame in which it becomes operational. But I think, you know, there were also protests at Kundakolam, you know, power plant. So I think those hurdles would be overcome, and Prime Minister Modi assured the French that, you know, those problems will be resolved. But I think from the long-term country scenario, we are now seeing oil at about $50 or so. But don't forget, you know, for a long duration, it was about $100 plus, which has a strong impact on our foreign exchange situation. I think in the long run, A, because we have to diversify to renewables, the strong thrust of the present government on 10 times the sourcing from solar power, nuclear power does represent, you know, an option in the long run for clean energy.
So both can coexist. Marshal Kak, how significant is the space cooperation between France and India? And why don't we hear much about it? After all, the French have launched 18 satellites for India. We've launched 2. We jointly produced 2 satellites, Megatropic and Saral. Yet, you know, everything is about nuclear and fighter jets.
I'm so glad that you brought this thing on the table because, you know, when we go back to U.S. cooperation, Condoleezza Rice said that, you know, we will make India a great power. French have contributed to India being a space power from day one. It is an old strategic partnership which Rakesh referred to, which has over the years built up so substantially that the space is one of our key areas of cooperation with France. And it's done very silently, quietly, behind the back between ISRO and the French agencies. Satellite launch, you yourself said. Now we are seeing GSLV being launched from there and our PSLV for their rocket. Yeah. So there is a collaboration both ends of the spectrum. And I think the space is also nuclear power. We should not, I mean, there is going to be a strong public sentiment against nuclear power. Kundakolam and Jaitapur have been examples. But this is also a way to go about requirement of energy so huge.
No, I couldn't
so
agree.
Huge.
I couldn't agree with you more. Now, Master Sood, you talked earlier about the ignored leg of the strategic partnership, that is, you know, relations between our business communities and, you know, the investment in each other's countries. Now, this time there were 2 roundtables, one on the manufacturing sector and one on infrastructure, which the Prime Minister attended.
Correct.
Now, do you think that is changing now?
I think this is the area which needs attention because what has happened is that we, you know, about 5 years ago, we had set up a target of 12 billion euros of bilateral trade. And we've not been able to meet that target. Our bilateral trade is still in the ballpark of about 7.5 billion, far short of the target. The same is true in terms of FDI, foreign investment coming in from France and vice versa. So these are some of the areas. This, coupled with increasing exchanges in the educational field, more Indian students traveling to France. We have about 2,000, 2,500 students going a year to France.
That's nothing.
China has about, there are about 25 to 30,000 Chinese students going to France every year. So you see the gap.
Okay.
So these are some of the areas of focus also in the joint statement.
Okay, we're running out of time. A last question, a short answer to you. Now, the French are very keen on addressing the issues of climate change. They're hosting the UN conference on climate change later this year. Do you think India would be able to protect its interests and at the same time not stick out like a sore thumb, you know, the perpetual dissenter in these issues?
I think negotiations in Paris are going to be very difficult. Yeah. India will maintain its position, yeah, but at the same time show dynamism that, yes, we're willing to do, but we're not going to sacrifice our basic national interests.
Very difficult task, but we've run out of time. I'd like to thank all my guests, Air Marshal Kapil Kak, Professor Jain, Ambassador Rakesh Sood. Thank you for coming here and participating in this discussion. That's all we have for you today. We'll be back again next week as usual. Till then, goodbye, and thanks for watching India's World.